that's what happens when the lead guitar player is playing in the key of D and the bass player is playing it in the key of E. And so my microphone's louder than his microphone, so I can just drown him right out, right? So the bottom line, Lord loves us, right? And we are happy to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. We had some technical difficulties and we were working on it. And Miss Little Drummer Boy said, "Are you ready?" And I said, "I think I am." And I started the song and I was in the wrong key. So that's how that goes. And hear that noise right there? That's what we're trying to get rid of. See how easy it is? You just say it and it's gone. Let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. I'm so happy to be here, Lord, in your presence. I know the people are here. If things are bothering you and you're out in the congregation, you're out on watching us on the internet, Lord, just put all those things away, Lord. Just help us stay focused on you, and we'll do that very thing. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Clothed in majesty, let all mic on. Now my mic is on. Now everybody can hear me. Good morning. Welcome to church. Glad you're here. It's one of those days, Catherine. It really is. I started my day, I went into my office, walked to my office and went, exactly, why am I here? Ed walks in and I'm like, he starts talking to me, I'm going, Ed, I have no idea what, I purposely walked from here to my office, I still don't know why. I've been hanging around Catherine for far too long, maybe. Okay. No, I'm still trying to figure out. I know there's a reason why, and I'm not going to figure it out until I'm 100 miles away and go, oh, that's right. That's right. So I want to do something just a little bit different. Just a little bit. God has to be doing something good to somebody. And I want to hear that. So who's going to tell me something God is doing good for them? You will?
Yeah. All right.
Yeah, I got it turned on.
1, 2. All right. So, just really quick, Deb and I got stranded out in the woods. We were like 18 miles away from anybody else, right? We had seen nobody out in the woods. We were on this little four-wheeler. And we've been practicing. I welcome you to come Wednesday nights because this is an example of what we've learned. Is when do we ask God for help? Is it our default or is it something that we struggle with for 2 hours and finally we say, God, can you help me? Well, Mr. Miller taught us that it should be our first default. So Deb and I, right that second, we said, I'm going to pray, and 1 minute and 30 seconds later, the guy comes by. Isn't that a blessing?
Mm-hmm.
Right. And he literally rescued us because Deb can't. You know, she has bad knees. She couldn't walk 18 miles out of the woods. She'd be like a horse. I'd have to shoot her.
You know, see, the thing is
you know,
he's talking
I'd
about
feel really bad if I had to do
he's
that.
He's talking
right?
about Deb not being able to walk 18 miles.
Yeah.
He can't walk 18
can,
miles
yeah,
either.
Yeah.
So,
so anyway, the bottom line is God is good, and if we put him, if we. My testimony is you put him first, you can't go wrong. And you preach so often that love is what it's all about. It is for me.
All right. So as we devote to 242, we read scripture. How many minutes a day? 7 minutes a day. Who doesn't have 7 minutes available? Yeah, we all have 7 minutes available, right? And when you read it, don't think about it. Just read it. Think about it, but don't come at it with preconceived ideas and preconceived notions, right? How often do we open scripture, or already thinking we know exactly what it says? It happens, right? I do it. There are sections of scripture I'm like, okay, I've read that 100 times. I think I'll just not read it because it's the same old, same old. Read it without a preconceived idea, and the Holy Spirit may just reveal something different to you than you thought. It does happen when we open ourselves up, and it's simply open yourself up and allow that. Something else we do is we devote ourselves to the fellowship. We devote ourselves to the fellowship. Sandy, you got to turn it off. You got to turn that off. You got to turn that camera off. Why don't you turn it off? No, I'm not going to do something weird, but I'm going to do something I don't want recorded. lunch yesterday. I don't remember how many people were there. I didn't count. But it was a good time. Good seeing everybody after a few months off. Sitting down, I was talking to Sharon. Not that Sharon, a different Sharon. And she was just yapping away, talking my ear off. You know, and that's why we're there, to build community and build community of believers. Next month is October 19th, also again at Holly Calvary, but hosted by Holly Calvary instead of Carpenter's Church. It's interesting because Carpenter's Church hosted yesterday, and Liz helped them. Y'all know Liz, right? She's probably online today, so she's not here. She's usually online. She's listening to us. And that's how we work together. Yeah, right? We work together as a church. Catherine, you both were there. It was a great day, wasn't it? Yeah. And that's what we're supposed to do. The food pantry at Holly Calvary, we partner with them by bringing food in, by putting underneath the table. Right? And it's open on Mondays and Wednesdays in the morning from 9 to 2. It's open from Thursdays from 6 to 8. That Thursday night time slot is because of the Community Unite initiative. The fact that we are helping partner with them with a food pantry and bringing food to them is because of the Community Unite initiative. The initiative is that we help the community as the church. I wish we'd get more churches involved, but we have what we have, and good things are happening. Every time I bring in food, every Monday I'm bringing in a whole tote full of food. Some Mondays, the tote is flowing over. And people that I set the food down in front of that are working the food pantry, they're beside themselves. And they're thanking us with partnering with them in their ministry. So it's easy. You go to the store, you go to buy an item, preferably a non-perishable item, for yourself, buy two of them, bring that second one into the food pantry. Bring food in that you will eat. Because if we're doing it saying, oh, I'm going to buy my food, and I'm going to go and buy something less expensive or something less delicious, is that really in the spirit of what we should be doing? Exactly. It's not, right? We should give more to others than we give to ourselves. Ed, can I get you to come up? Thank you. Father, we thank you for your love, for your grace, and your mercy. Lord, as we take a few moments to give back to you, Father, I just ask that you take this offering, and Lord, that you multiply it to do infinitely more than we ask or we think. And Lord, you just blow our minds as we are faithful to you, how much more faithful you are to us. Holy Spirit, help us to be joyful givers. As an act of worship, when we give back to you, help us to remember all that you've done for us and all that you're still doing and all that you're going to do. And help us to say thank you, Lord, for blessing us beyond measure. In your name we pray, amen. Oh yeah, if Sandy, if you want to put the Facebook back on, it's your call. If you want to put Facebook back on, that's your call. You already did? Okay. Yes. Technology works today. Will and I were working on it, and Will is watching me work. I said, okay, Will, I had it working earlier, right? So he always talks about, I use my tablet, right? He goes, what happens if your tablet doesn't work anymore? You know what the beauty about being the pastor? No, you guys have no idea what I'm going to say, right? So if I say something wrong, it doesn't matter. I can say anything, and you'll never know it. But today, what I want to do is I want to start by reading a bit of a sermon called The Measure of Greatness by Brent Blair. Some years ago, St. Paul's School of Theology in Kansas City was seeking a new president. Over 100 candidates applied for the position. The search committee narrowed the list down to 5 eminently qualified persons. Then someone came up with the bright idea. Let's send a person to the institutions of where each of the 5 finalists are currently employed, and let's interview the janitor at each place, asking him what he thinks of the man seeking to be our president. This was done, and a janitor gave such glowing appraisal of William McClavany that he was selected president of the St. Paul School of Theology. Somebody on that search committee understood in a flash of genius that those who live close to Christ become so secure in his love that they no longer relate to people by their position, their rank, their power, or their money. They treat janitors and governors with equal dignity. They regard everybody as a VIP. Children do this intuitively. Adults have to relearn it. Right? Yeah, for sure. And you think about that. A president of the university, this guy, why is he going to know a janitor? He should. Right, he should, and that's just it. I'm going to treat the janitor with the same respect I treat everybody else. That's what we're supposed to be. It does go to that adage. It goes to the adage, treat people the way you want to be treated, but it also goes to something else we're going to talk about today. And we're going to talk about esteeming people higher than we esteem ourselves. It even goes beyond treating people like I want to be treated, right? But however, when I read this sermon, I totally understood this concept. I get it. I completely get it. I'm not impressed by someone's rank or privilege. The other day at work, we have a new CEO. He came around the corner and I said, "So you still think you made the right decision?" Yeah. I told my boss that I told that to the CEO. She's like, "What? You said that?" "Oh, yeah, I did." "Why? He's just somebody else. He's just another guy. Not any different than anybody else, right? So why not talk to him like everybody else?" And he said yes. He said yes. So far, so good, right? He could be lying to me, but that's beside the point. But unfortunately, my treatment of people hasn't always been the best. Nobody would never know that, you know, because I treat everybody great. But no, I didn't used to. And I've come a long, long way. I mean, I really have, because way back when, not that far ago, the world revolved around who? No, the world revolved around me, right? No, I'm sorry. You've been trained that's revolved around Will, but no, the world literally revolves around me. But I have this ability, how will you believe it, I have this ability to look through people, that they don't even exist. It is. You know what I like to do when somebody's walking their dog? I go and pet their dog and never acknowledge there's a person there. That's upside down. That's how bad it is, right? But I recognize that, and I know it's not supposed to be that way. So now I actually talk to the person as well. I recognize that they're there first before I pet their dog. But it has literally taken a great deal of prayer to get to the point to finally realize that the world does not revolve around Dan. Really, it does. I know, I absolutely know it doesn't revolve around me. I know I'm supposed to see people as Christ sees them. I know I'm supposed to put people above myself. Why? Because Scripture tells me that. These are the things I know. But I have to pray, Holy Spirit, help my actions follow what I know. Just because we know to do the right thing doesn't mean we're going to do the right thing. And I totally, completely understand that I am the only person in this room that believed the world revolved around them. You know, I am literally the only person. Yep. Unfortunately, it's a standard human trait, isn't it? And if we're honest with ourselves, that mindset creeps in more than we'd like to admit. Most of us, believe it or not, think we're better than we are. Bruce is amazing. See, he thinks he's better than he is. Go play pickleball with him. You'll find out just not how amazing he is. Right? But it's We delude ourselves into thinking that we're better than we are. That's who we're created to be, folks. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. God created us to be awesome. He wants us to be more awesome every day. We are totally supposed to be excellent, and we are excellent. But the oxymoron in Scripture is that we are the greatest of all time, yet we should seek to be the least of all time. We are the greatest, yet we should seek to be the least. It's an oxymoron, isn't it? Yes, it is. And Jesus says it in Mark 9. In Mark 9, we read in verse 33, after they arrived at Capernaum and settled in a house, Jesus asked his disciples, "What were you discussing out on the road?" They didn't answer, because they had been arguing about which of them is the greatest. He sat down, called the 12 disciples over to him, and said, "Whoever wants to be first must take last place and be the servant of everybody else." Our buddy Luke also wrote about the same story in Luke 9, verse 46. Then his disciples began arguing about which one of them is the greatest. But Jesus knew their thoughts, so he brought a little child to his side, and he said to them, "Anyone who welcomes a little child like this on my behalf welcomes me. And anyone who welcomes me also welcomes my Father who sent me. Whoever is the least among you is the greatest." Whoever is the least among you is the greatest. So here we have the 12 disciples, and they're arguing amongst each other. Who is the greatest of them all? Now, we have disciples like Peter. Peter was pretty great. I mean, we see a lot of interaction between Peter and a lot of interaction between Jesus. And you know, at one point, Jesus is actually saying, "Hey, Peter, you know, upon my church, I'll build this rock," and all the rest of that stuff. And his first name was Simon, and Jesus renamed him Peter. So Peter was pretty great. So I could see Peter. "Oh, no, guys, I'm the best. Jesus renamed me. I don't know who you guys think you are." Right? As they're walking. And Andrew's like, "All right, Andrew," he's Peter's brother. You know how brothers, they always agree. He's like, "Dude, Simon, get over yourself. I'm not calling you Peter. Not going to do it. You are Simon. And I am better than you," because, well, I think they said, was Andrew older? Or Peter was older. I don't remember. You know what? I've read both. Nobody actually knows who was older, whether it was Andrew or whether it was Peter. I know. But Jesus called Andrew and Peter at the same time. Right? They're both fishermen. Jesus is walking along and said, "Hey, you two, come with me. I'll teach you how to fish for men." So Andrew and Peter, they had a pretty good argument of why they were the greatest, because they were picked first. Obviously, I'm picked first. I have to be greater. And they argued who would be the greatest, because brothers always argue about who's the greatest. I mean, Don and I, you know, it's a well-known fact that I'm the best-looking brother. You know? But I can't say. I'm not going to rabbit trail down that one. But as they're arguing, here's John. And John's like, "All right, Peter, Andrew, I'm the beloved disciple. Jesus loves me the most. Therefore, I am the greatest." And he's the one that, he writes the book of John and says, "Jesus loves me the most." Whether it's true or not, that's what he writes. You know, he thinks pretty highly of himself. And so they're arguing. They're bickering back and forth. And Matthew's like, "You guys are nothing but fishermen. I'm a tax collector. I went to school. I'm smarter than you guys." And the argument goes on and on and on and on. Could you imagine Jesus just hanging his head? "Oh my gosh, you guys, you're killing me." Yeah, pretty much that's what he's saying, right? You guys just aren't getting the picture. And they argue. And they argue. And they argue. Jesus is like, "Hey, let's understand something. I want you to understand who is going to be the greatest among you. Whoever wants to be first," they're starting out right, right? Jesus is starting out right. "Whoever wants to be first," they're like, "Oh yeah, he's going to tell me what I got to do. Whoever wants to be first has to be the servant of everybody else." excuse me, Jesus? He says, if you didn't catch that, guys, I want you, if you didn't catch it, I'm just going to say it one more time. Seek to be the least among you, then you'll be the greatest. Seek to be the least among you, then you'll be the greatest. Of course, the disciples, like us, say it once, they got it down. They nailed it, right? We're slow to learn. They were slow to learn. So much so that they're sitting around at the Last Supper still arguing with one another. Luke 22, and they began to argue amongst themselves about who would be the greatest among them. All right, now I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, all right, this is mentioned twice in Luke. Twice. Do you think this only happened twice? No. This is a continual argument that they had all the time about who is the greatest among them. So much so they're having it's the Passover supper. They're supposed to be celebrating the deliverance of God, and they're arguing about who's the greatest among them. Jesus told them, in this world, the kings and great men lord it over their people, yet they are called friends of the people. But among you it will be different. Those who are the greatest among you should take the lowest rank, and the leader should be like the servant. Who wants to be the least among us? We should all want to, exactly, Diane. We should all want to. I'm asking the question. Everyone's like, not me. I don't want to be the least. No way. Right? However, what does Jesus say? Want to be the greatest? Seek to be the lowest rank. Seek to serve everybody else. Now, it's interesting for me. If I'm working at being the least among you, so I can be the greatest. Is that in the right spirit of the thought? No. Right? Because then I'm ultimately looking for that greatness. He's saying these things so that we learn to serve other people, so we learn to see other people better than I see myself. Right? How do I take these words of Jesus and how do I actually put them into practice? I should seek to be the least. I should seek to be the least, but how do I do that? Our buddy Paul nails it in three distinct sentences in Philippians. Philippians 2, 3 and 4. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. Piece of cake, right? Yeah, piece of cake. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. So don't worry if it's out or not, Diane. They were playing pickleball and they're arguing about who's out, right? Okay, don't be selfish. If it's out, it's out. If it's, who cares? Yeah. Well, I mean, the thing is, I know. They didn't know they were going to be part of the sermon this morning. You know. But how often are we selfish? All the time, right? Yeah, and we often do try to impress other people. That's, again, just something that is our sinful nature, believe it or not. We're not supposed to be selfish. I don't do stuff to impress people. I'm pretty impressive. But I don't do things to impress people. Right, that's the mindset I'm supposed to have. So when I go into work, I go in to do my job. I know I'm good at what I do. God has given me some fantastic talents. I try not to be the smartest person in the room. It's hard. It is hard. No, when you go into a room and you're trying to teach people or show people something, and you know that you have the facts and the statistics to back up what you're saying, and none of them believe you, how do you go in there and not try to impress people with the right answer? It's hard. It can be hard. Another thing that Paul says, be humble, thinking others as better than yourself. Who should we think better than ourselves? Everybody. Everybody that we come in contact with, we should esteem them better than ourselves. Other versions of the Bible use esteem others better than you esteem yourself. So just for fun, online, I typed in, how do I esteem others better than myself? Do you know that there's 500,000 different ways to do so? I'm only going to go through 9 of them. Interesting, because don't assume others have exactly the same evil motives as you find in your heart. Wait, don't assume others have exactly the same evil motives as you find in your own heart. So that's what I'm saying, right? So when we're having an interaction, Deb and I have an interaction, and Deb does something, I'm going to, whatever evil intentions I have, I'm going to think she has them automatically. Right? She's doing this to get me. Deb's just doing whatever Deb does. Deb could care less about me at this point, but she's doing it to get me. Because I already have that mindset that she's, whatever she's doing, because the world revolves around who? Me. Everything Deb does must be against me. So Terry, when you go to work and that guy's not doing what he's supposed to do, right? Just don't even think about your intentions. Don't put your intentions on somebody else. It's hard to do. Look for those virtuous qualities in others that you know you're in the most need of. If I'm looking at somebody else, again, esteeming them higher than I esteem myself, what qualities do they have that I would like to have? Don't assume that your time, money, and energy, don't assume that your time, money, energy, thoughts, and opinions are more valuable than your neighbor's. Don't assume that your time, money, energy, thoughts, and opinions are more valuable than your neighbor's. And who's your neighbor? Everybody, right? Literally everybody's your neighbor. When making a decision, consider not only how that decision will affect your interests, but how it will affect the interests of others. That's a tough one. That kind of goes back to that don't be selfish. When making a decision, consider not only how that decision will affect your own interests, but how it will affect somebody else's interests. Be alert not only to your own needs, but to the needs of others. Demonstrate your estimation of others by commending them for those qualities that are biblically worthy of praise. What is biblically worthy of praise? Love, kindness. Fruits of the Spirit. Interesting, because Paul says, now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable. So anything that's true and lovely and pure doesn't have to be something that's holy, right? Somebody does something that you think is the right thing to do. Right? How many things are the right thing to do? How often do we praise people for just doing things? Guard your heart from developing a pattern of critical, condemnatory, accusatory, judgmental thoughts about others. How many people look at other people and condemn them? How often do we sit around a dinner table and start complaining about people and how stupid they are? You laugh, but it's tough to not have judgmental thoughts against people, is it not? How do we look at people and esteem them above ourselves? How do we change that Pray for your brothers and sisters in Christ. Remind yourself often that God has given you everything you had to be proud of, and that he has often used others to get you where you are. Remind yourself often that God has given you everything you had to be proud of. You are awesome. You're becoming awesomer every day. And how are you doing that? Through other people. God's using other people to make you better, to make you more excellent. Esteem others higher than yourself. Look at them and think they're better than me. It's a difficult mindset to get into. And he says, don't look out for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. That means I have to notice people. All people. Everybody. From the janitor to the CEO. And look out for their interests and not my own interests. In the words of Bill and Ted, be excellent to one another. Be excellent to one another. Right? And how am I supposed to be excellent to one another? In every single interaction we have with people, how do I help Chuck succeed? How do I help Bruce succeed? How do I help you become a better drummer? I can't. I can't keep a beat. But that's the thing. We should be, every interaction, how can I esteem Sheila more than myself? Do we do that? Think of that person at work that really irritates you. How do we esteem them better than ourselves? Sheila, thanks God she's retired. Right? But it's a tough thing to do. To become the least among you, and to do it not because I want to be the greatest, because I want to esteem you higher than I esteem myself. I want to look out for your interests and not my own interests. Trust me, it's a long, hard, difficult walk. It's not something that happens overnight. It really isn't. You're going to have to think about it and think about it and think about it and pray about it and pray about it and pray about it. You're going to have to reframe your thinking to seek to be the least. Reframe how you think. Seek to be the least. Jesus said, whoever wants to be first must take last place and be the servant of everyone else. Whoever is the least among you is the greatest. Those who are the greatest among you should take the lowest rank, and the leader should be like a servant. Change the way you think. You change the way you think, you know what's going to happen? You're going to change the way you act. First, you've got to change your thoughts. Then your actions will come forth. And Paul also said in three distinct sentences, don't be selfish, don't try to impress others, be humble, thinking of others better than yourselves, don't look out for your own interests, but take interest in others too. Do you actively seek to be the least? Do you actively seek to be the least? Do you esteem others as better than you are? You actively look out for the interest of others. If you don't, change your mindset. Start seeking to be the least. It'll take lots of prayer and intentionality to do so. Lots of prayer and intentionality to do so. If you'd like help with getting there, talk to somebody here. Right? As believers, we're supposed to do what? Help each other, encourage each other, esteem one another higher than we esteem ourselves. If you are weak in this particular concept, and you know you are, let's talk about it. Let's pray about it. Because once you admit that, then we can go forward. Once you admit that, it's like, yes. Once you go to prayer and say, Lord, help me to esteem others better than myself, Jesus is going to say, no way. No, he's not. He's going to say, yes! Whenever you take something to prayer that's one of his concepts to make yourself better, he's having a party. Yeah, they got it. Woo-hoo! They're coming to me to get better. They're coming to me to learn to be excellent to one another. Let's do that. Let's seek to be the least among us. Father, we thank you for your love, for your grace, and your mercy. And Lord, Holy Spirit, help us. Help us to humble ourselves. Help us to look out for the interest of others. Help us to esteem others higher than we esteem ourselves. Help us to seek to be the least among us. Not because we want to be the greatest, but because we love people with love that only comes from you. And Holy Spirit, help us to reframe our thinking. To reframe our thinking to look at everybody and every interaction, no matter what, and to see people as better than we see ourselves. Help us to try and understand our thoughts when we project them on somebody else. That they may not have that thought at all. Help us have the best thoughts in our heads towards everybody. And help us to be the church that you created us to be the masterpiece that we are. In your name we pray, amen. Those online, have a fantastic week. Those who are here, we have...